Here's the thing. Tonight, I want to talk about something that's been on my heart in the last, I'd probably say, month. It's just been something that is really, really just weighing on me. I've been really passionate about it. God's been speaking to me personally about this. And I just want to talk tonight about the power of influence. The power of influence. I want to start tonight by looking at the definition of influence, and it is this: the capacity to have an effect on the character, development, or behavior of someone or something. If you have your Bibles, you can turn to Matthew chapter 5, verse 13. Jesus is speaking and he's teaching the church and he's talking to believers here. And he says something interesting to them. He says, "You are the salt of the earth. But what good is salt if it has lost its flavor? Can you make it salty again? It will be thrown out and trampled underfoot as worthless. You are the light of the world, like a city on a hilltop that cannot be hidden. No one lights a lamp and then puts it under a basket. Instead, a lamp is placed on a stand where it gives light to everyone in the house." Believers here are described as two things: salt and light. Two very influential things. Salt, when it comes in contact with something, it has influential power. When light invades a space or is turned on, it immediately changes what it's in and what it's around. These two things are influential. And God would describe the believers as salt and as light. Let's pray. Father, we love you. We thank you for your word. We thank you for your presence. We thank you that you have already done miracles. You are already delivered. You have already set people free. I thank you for your hope. I thank you for your grace. I thank you that this is a moment we can gather together and release our faith to you and watch you pour down blessing. Watch you speak specifically to each of us. And that is our desire, is that we would leave this place very different than the way we came in. So speak to our hearts, both here and those watching. And we love you and we glorify you and we thank you for your word. In Jesus' name, and all the passionate believers said, amen. Amen. Come on, give God one big shout of praise if you got it. Well, it's football season. Anybody excited about football season? I'm excited about it. A great friend of mine who's a pastor reminded me last week of the power of the huddle in a football game. There's a huddle, we all see it, where the quarterback kind of pulls all the team together and they call a play. And the huddle happens, you know, throughout the game, and they gather together and they're all tight, they're all around the quarterback, and all of a sudden there's the direction. Blue 42, this is what we're gonna run. I need you to go on motion. I need you to attack that hole. I need you to make that block. I need you to do this. I need you to do that. All right, are you guys ready? You good? And the design of the huddle is to give clear instruction, make sure everybody's on the same page. They break the huddle, and then they're supposed to execute what is called in the huddle against the opposition. Now, how crazy would it be if the team never broke the huddle? If they're standing around and they're making the call and they start getting really hyped. Yeah, let's go. We're gonna crush them. Yeah, you're gonna go in motion. You're gonna do that. You're gonna destroy them. I need you to run this play. I need you to run that assignment. But then they never break the huddle. How foolish would that be? While the other team is over here waiting, watching them dance around, get excited about the play, get excited about what they're supposed to do, but they never break the huddle. You see, the church, friends, according to Matthew, is designed to have moments where we gather. Never forsake the gathering of the brethren. There's moments where we gather and we huddle and our faith is strengthened. Where we get revelation, we come together, we lift each other, we pray for one another. We hear messages and we lift our voices in worship. It's a powerful moment. But then we're designed by Christ to break this huddle, each with its own assignment, and we are supposed to execute his plan and his will into the world, into our workplaces, into our universities, into our neighborhoods, into our apartment complexes, fleshing out who God is, being salt and being light, influencing the spaces that God has put us in. But oftentimes, It seems that we're almost using the four walls of the church to be a basket that we are keeping our light in. When Matthew says, what good is light under a basket? Light needs to be out. Light needs to be on a hilltop. Light needs to shine out for everybody to see. You've been designed to influence. You've been designed to change the atmospheres of your workplace, of the place you live, your family, the relationships you step into, the coffee shop, the lunchroom, the gym. Wherever you go, God has designed you and put power in you to influence and change the setting that He has planted you in. I know in our culture we hear this word influencer, and in today's age it's easy to buy into this lie and this idea that influencers are just those who have a YouTube channel or a blue check next to their name on social media. But the truth is, each of us have been given a measure of influence to steward. Each and every one of us, under the sound of my voice, as believers, you have been given a measure of influence. And God wants to use you to change the circumstances and surroundings that He has placed you in. And the question tonight is not if you can or are influencing. That's not the question. The better question is, how are you influencing? And what are you doing to influence? And what are you influencing people towards? In Corinthians, 2 Corinthians, Paul is writing to the believers in Corinth, and he paints a picture of Macedonia. And I want to read in 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 5, what he describes. These are the conditions in this region. Paul says, when we arrived in Macedonia, there was no rest for us. We faced conflict from every direction, with battles on the outside and fear on the inside. But God, who encourages those who are discouraged, encouraged us by the arrival of Titus. His presence was a joy, but so was the news that he brought. Get the context here. Macedonia is filled with drama and gossip. Macedonia is filled with a whole lot of anxiety, a whole lot of fear. And Paul is in the middle of it, and he's overwhelmed even with what he's surrounded by. But look what happens here. God wants to help. According to 2 Corinthians 5:20, he calls you and I his ambassadors. He's making his appeal through you and I. And in this case, this man named Titus is just willing. He's just saying, I'll go, I'll show up. And Titus, this one guy, shows up, and his sheer presence was a joy. His sheer presence changed the atmosphere. The fact that he would even just show up began this change, this change of the spiritual climate in Macedonia. It wasn't just that he taught the good news, is that his presence was joy. His demeanor, what was on his life, began to permeate the drama and the fear and the anxiety. Sounds like some environments that you and I engage every single day. Your workplace, full of drama. Uh-huh. Your sports team that you just made, full of drama and politics, the apartment complex, the wherever you find yourself in your life today, there can be anxiety, there can be fear, there can be worry. And I don't know about you, but I want to be like Titus. I want to be able to step into whatever space God has called me to, and I want the sheer presence of God that rests on the inside to come into that area, and the whole climate changes because I showed up and the God inside of me revealed himself. This is the power of the believer, the influential power that each and every one of us possesses. Often untapped, often unaware of, but God says you have influence. It'd been easy for Titus, I think, after a long day of travel, a couple Ubers that he caught, he's probably exhausted, shows up in Macedonia, is like, man, I don't know. This place is overwhelmed with drama. There's gossip everywhere. People are hating and lying. There's fear everywhere. Paul's even in the middle of it, losing his mind. I don't know if I can do this. Been easy, probably, to allow the mess to get on the inside of him and discourage him and detour and derail the mission that God had for him in that moment. But Titus understood something. He understood his power. He understood what he possessed in Christ. And that was the ability to step into the mess without allowing the mess to get on the inside of him. I don't know who I'm preaching to, but you have great power, friend. And you don't have to allow the mess that you are surrounded by at work or in your family or on your sports team to get on the inside of you. You possess the Holy Spirit. You have power. You are a container of God. And you can step into those spaces and influence those around you. What helped? I think he was going in on mission. I don't think he was waiting to see what it was going to be like and then react. I think he went on, prayed up, knowing that God was sending him there to change, to bring his power, to influence, not just to walk up casually and just, hey, I'll just let whatever happens, happens. I think he was on mission. And to me, it's the difference between a thermometer and a thermostat. See, as believers, we're called to be thermostats. Salt and light, they are proactively changing whatever they come in contact with. A thermometer just has the ability to come in contact with something and give you the display, right? It's the temperature of the meat is. It's the thermometer, this is the temperature of the body. This is the temperature. But a thermostat has the ability not just to gauge the temperature, but to change the temperature, to change the climate. So when it's 125 degrees in Houston in the summer, you see that thermostat and you can change that thermostat down to 70 and the appropriate climate begins to take place into that room, into that space. It's the power of the thermostat. Friends, as a believer, that's exactly who you've been commissioned to be, as a person who brings change, a person that impacts, a person that influences. God's anointed you to do that. He's prepared you to do that. He's put himself inside his spirit on the inside so that you could be an influencer. We're Christ's ambassadors, not being influenced by our surroundings and what's trending and what's popular, but stepping into our spaces on mission to shine, to lift, to encourage, ushering heaven to earth in every coffee shop, in every restaurant, in every auto mechanic, in every place, every school, every college campus, every corporation, every cubicle, that we would bring heaven to earth by the way we live, by showing up. And what happens? People are glad that we did. People are grateful that we showed up. Paul was pretty happy that Titus came that day and began to influence a whole lot of chaos. In the same context of salt and light in Mark chapter 4, Jesus would go on to describe the kingdom and believers as something else. He would give us another visual, and I find it very interesting. He says in chapter 4, verse 30, "How can I describe the kingdom of God? What story should I use to illustrate it? It is like a mustard seed planted in the ground. It is the smallest of all seeds, but it becomes the largest of all garden plants. It grows long branches, and birds can make nests in its shade." See the image here? The image is a planted tree. It's a planted tree. It begins to grow fruit. It begins to expand. It begins to mature, and it begins to spread out. But then the last part's interesting to me, because then it begins to provide shade. It begins to influence those things that are around it. It begins to lighten the load for these birds. It begins to lighten the load for the things that are around it. It becomes a safe haven, you could say. Friends, the question tonight isn't, where do I go to influence? The question tonight is, where has God planted you right now to influence? God has planted you somewhere. I meet people all the time that just pray, God, just send me. God, put me in Africa somewhere. God, take me across over here so I can impact there. Now, there's nothing wrong with all of those things. But oftentimes, God has planted you somewhere right now and positioned you in a place of influence. And we're so busy about reaching a place of influence or getting to a platform or getting an audience or getting a blue check that we're missing the opportunities that we have every single day to lift and to love and to encourage people. God has planted you somewhere. You don't need to look any further. You don't need to reach some pedestal to start influencing. God has positioned you and he's planted you somewhere, right at that retail store. He's designed you to influence that area and to bring shade and to bring encouragement and love. Our attitude should be, God, I'm not looking ahead for more influence. You've given me a measure of influence right where I'm at. And I believe that you're gonna shine through me. And I believe people are gonna see you on the inside of me. They're gonna see you through my actions. They're gonna see you through my smile. They're gonna see you through my attitude. And that's gonna permeate this store that I'm working in right now. It may not be the end goal, but God, you have a purpose in this season for me right where I'm at. Come on, is there any believers here ready to be used by God? Ready to influence? I'm passionate about this just because I see people missing great opportunities to be used by God. There's not a greater feeling and reality than to know God wants to use you every single day. That the God of the universe has planted you somewhere specifically to take care of and to relay a message to his most prized possession, and that's people. I know they get on your nerves. I know they're full of drama. I know the person right next to you even gets under your skin a little bit. But the reality is that person God breathed life into. God loves them. And God wants you to be a vessel of influence to show them who he is. He is making his appeal through your life to those around you. I want to be influential right where I find my 2 feet. Wherever my 2 feet find me, whether it's at an airport, whether it's in Africa, whether it's in Houston, whether it's on the north side, east side, west side, wherever I find my feet, God, you've planted me here. I want to be salt and I want to be light. I'm not looking ahead for more influence. I'm not looking to make an impact when I get there or when I graduate or I get my seminary degree. Right here is where I want to make a difference. This is where God has me. In Daniel, we see an interesting story. We see an interesting dynamic. Province of Babylon, King Nebuchadnezzar, obsessed with control, builds this massive statue 90 foot tall, created an idol worshiping culture, ordered everyone, every race, creed, color to worship this statue. And if they didn't worship this statue, they would be thrown into a flaming furnace. Living in this area, in these conditions, were three young adults, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. This is where God planted them. This is where God had them, and they trusted in God, and they refused to bow down to this statue. And look what happens in verse 24. The king was so mad when he found out that they refused, he turned the heat up 7 times, bound them with ropes, threw them in. Verse 24, suddenly King Nebuchadnezzar jumped up in alarm and said, "Didn't we throw 3 men bound hand and foot into the fire? But look," he said, "I see 4 men walking around freely in the fire, completely unharmed, and the fourth looks like a son of the gods." Nebuchadnezzar went to the door of the roaring furnace and called in, "Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, servants of the high God, come out here." Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego walked out of the fire. Verse 27, catch this. All the important people, the VPs, the managers, all the government leaders and king's counselors gathered around to examine them and discovered that the fire hadn't so much as touched the 3 men, not a hair singed, not a scorch mark on their clothes, not even the smell of fire on them. And Nebuchadnezzar said, "Blessed be the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. He sent his angel and rescued his servants who trusted in him. They ignored the king's orders and laid their bodies on the line rather than serve or worship any god but their own. Therefore, I issue this decree. Anyone, anywhere, of any race, color, or creed who says anything against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego will be ripped to pieces limb from limb and their houses torn down. There has never been a God who can pull off a rescue like this." Now, here's what's interesting. three guys changed the entire spiritual climate of this region. Three. They're outnumbered, just like many of you. In your families, in your teams, the workplace, the gym, the coffee, wherever you find yourself, you feel outnumbered. How am I going to make a difference? It's just me. Here's three guys. But because God's in the mix, these three had the majority. These three had the influence. These three had the power of God around them. And because they were willing to trust God right where God had planted them, God caused all these influential people to come to them. All the officials, all the vice presidents, all the counselors. You don't need to chase after influence. When you trust God right where you're at, God will bring influencers to you. God will bring promotion to you. You don't need to go after it. If your heart's right and your goal is to serve God and live on mission and give him glory and love and lift people right where you're at your job, promotion will come to you. Because kingdom is at the forefront of your life. Making an impact in people, loving those that God has put around you. And this is what happens. My favorite verse, verse 30, to end the whole story. Then the king promoted Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the province of Babylon. They weren't trying to be famous. They were just trying to be impactful. And God increased their platform. You see, what I love is that here's the huddle. And they broke the huddle, and now they're out trying to live in the tension of this decree. And God says, I'm gonna promote you, but I don't want you to go back and live and keep the light under a basket. I'm gonna promote you right in Babylon, where I want my light to shine the brightest. Light does not work in darkness, or light does not work in light, right? Light only works best in darkness and in dark places. This is the heart of God for the church, for you and I, to be influencers. My wife was a dental hygienist for 10 years. And she spent most of those years in an office that was challenging, to say the least. Just gossip and drama and backbiting and politics and unfair things happening. And she'd come home with just the craziest stories, just unreal. Many times, even as we're eating dinner, she's just tempted to quit. Just tempted to move on to a different office, move on to another place. But she would always pray and always come back around to this idea that God has planted me there, Nick. And I'm supposed to be a light. I just know I'm there for a reason and a purpose. And it's beyond executing projects. It's beyond finishing a task. It's beyond cleaning teeth. I'm there to make an impact in these marriages. I'm there to lead people to Christ. I'm there to be an influencer. God has me there. And so she just began to pray for her coworkers. She began to, or continue to try to live in integrity and character. Try to be generous and compassionate. Try to work with excellence right where God had her. And wouldn't you know, over time, one by one, all these assistants start coming up to her. All these patients even started pulling her aside and just saying, there's something different about you. There's something different about you. You're not caught up in the gossip. You're always reacting positively. You're always loving people. Now, Summer will admit she was not perfect, but she would just consistently try to walk in on mission, knowing that God wanted to make an appeal through her life right there in the dentist office. And would you know that the questions mounted up so much where Summer one day had to bring her Bible into work, into the lunch break room, because she said so many questions were coming at me that I didn't even know the answers to. I had to bring the Bible and I had to flip open the Bible and actually show them where the answers were. She lived in such a way that people asked questions. What's different about you? Why are you living the way you live? Why are you always smiling when the boss is getting on you? There's something unique. There's something. See, God expects us to live in such a way that it compels people to ask questions. You see, what I love about Summer, what I love about these three young adults and even Titus is their impact and influence had little to do with their words, but everything to do with their actions. You see, a lot of people think, I can't influence. I can't speak very loudly. I'm not charismatic. But I've seen that the most influential people speak softly, but they live very loud. They speak soft, but they live very loud. They live loud with character. They live loud with generosity. They live loud with compassion. They live loud with justice and with peace and doing what they can to usher in those things onto their college campus and wherever they find themselves. I'll say it this way: always preach the gospel. When necessary, use words. See, you don't have to be the loudest to make the biggest impact. And you don't have to get the latest trends, be the coolest, say all the right things, have the right fashion, have all the right things together to make the most impact and influence where you are. Sometimes we get it twisted. We get caught up on things that have nothing to do with truly impacting someone who is discouraged or someone who needs hope. None of those things matter when someone is deeply hurting and needs a word of encouragement and needs love and needs peace. What matters is you being present. Titus's impact started with his willingness to show up. His willingness just to show up and say, God, this is where you have me. I'm going to show up on mission. I'm going to show up on purpose. In other words, this influence and this impact was about the ministry of his presence. The ministry of his presence. You see, people don't care what you know until they know that you care. You can come in with your Bible. We can come in with all of our scriptures. But people really don't want to know what we have to say until they know that we care. And that often is exemplified by our presence, our ability to show up. Here's an example. I remember being in high school and God was not on my radar. And I was playing Friday night football. And I remember this older lady. She's probably in her 60s. And she was this lovable, she was this genuine lady that started to show up to some of my football games in the bleachers. And afterwards, when we'd all come out of the locker room, she'd be standing saying hi to my family, hi to my mom. And eventually I started having these conversations after these games with her, and I was really impacted by her willingness to come, her willingness to watch, her taking interest in something that I loved. Well, fast forward, I found out that she was a local youth pastor. And I found myself 6 months later sitting at the back of a room of a service that she was preaching in. And she was talking about a relationship with God that I had no clue about. But I was open to what she was talking about because she was willing to come onto my turf and show up. She was willing to show me that she loved me and that she cared about me, which allowed me to go, all right, what do you got to say? Why? Because she gave me one of the most valuable things she possesses, and that's her time. And that pastor has made a dramatic impact and influence in my life to this day because of her willingness to show up. And there have been many people in my life that have made a drastic impact because they just had the willingness to sacrifice some time to show up when I was in the hospital, show up for a birthday, show up for a graduation, show up for a game. Show up for critical life moments that I had. And you could probably say the same about your own life. The people that have made the biggest impact and the biggest influence in your life were the ones who showed up and are showing up consistently. And so my question tonight is this: are we going to show up for people? Are we going to be believers that are willing to be there when everybody else may run out? Are we willing to show people that we truly care? Because I truly believe that if we develop this habit, God will begin to use us in some mysterious ways. When you surrender, when you live on mission, when you show up, you'll be shocked at what God starts doing through you to those around you. I was invited to this Texans practice a couple weeks ago when they were in training camp. And a friend of mine works for the Texans, and he's like a Titus. His presence is just joy. He's contagious. He loves God. He serves here. He's a fantastic friend. And he's like, hey, Nick, can you come? Do you want to just watch a practice? I said, sure, I'll come. So that morning, I woke up really early, drove there. And it's one of those mornings where I said, God, I don't know where my feet are going to land, but wherever they land, I want to love people. And I want to be aware. I was simmering on this message. I said, God, I'm just going to show up. I don't know what you want to do, but I'm going to be there. So I showed up watching this practice right on the field, and it's like 150 degrees and I am just sweating. I'm like, God, maybe I'm not supposed to be salt. I'm just supposed to sweat salt. I'm not quite sure. I missed the memo here. I'm just so hot watching this practice. And at the end of the practice, all the players and their families alone come on the field. That's all that was allowed to come on. And my friend says, hey, why don't you come out? I want to introduce you to some players. So I walk out there, and he starts introducing me. Hey, this is Nick. He's a pastor at Lakewood. And it's really kind of uncomfortable because I don't know really where to go. I mean, here's a full-blown professional athlete. He's tired. He's probably, hey, here's the pastor from, you know, he works at Lakewood. He's a pastor. And they're just like looking at me. And I'm like, good to meet you. God bless you. So, all right, next guy. I mean, what do you say? You know, great practice. You look hot, sweaty. Like, I mean, I don't know really what to say. Keep it real, right? Can't give him a Bible verse like right there. What do you say? But this one guy and I just started getting a conversation. And my friend didn't introduce me, so he didn't know what I did for a living. And we were talking about all kinds of things. And he introduced me to his wife and his baby, and all of a sudden, he just takes a step back, no joke. And he looks at me. He looks up and down. Just looks up at me. And he goes, "Hey." He goes, "What's at your core?" And I'm like, "Excuse me?" He goes, "What's at your core?" And I'm like, "Well, I have been doing some planks lately. I mean, I didn't say that. I'm just trying to figure out, like, what do you mean? It's just like so random. It's at the end of the practice. He's sweating. I can tell he's tired. There's like a lot going on. And he just stops me. He goes, "What's at your core?" And I'm like, "My faith. My faith is at my core. I mean, that's at the center of who I am. It impacts my relationships. It impacts my decisions. It impacts my marriage. It impacts everything that I do. My faith and my relationship with God is at my core." I mean, and he just goes, "All right, bet." And he walks away. Now, I don't know what that did for him, but it did a lot for me. Because all I did was show up, and all I did was handshake, and there was something about my presence just being there that provoked something in his spirit. It caused him to ask questions. It caused him to go, "Man, something's off about you. Something's different. Something's on your life." And I just began to talk to him just for 30 seconds about faith, relationship with God, and how it's changed my life with a big old smile. And I believe that seed wasn't wasted. That seed, any seed sowed in the kingdom, is never wasted. You may not see it come to fruition right there, but who's in charge of making the fruit grow? God is. Some plant, some water. God makes it grow. We're designed to show up. And you'd be surprised when you come into your workplace, navigating tough situations, navigating the fire. Maybe the prayer isn't, "God, take me out of the fire. Take me out of this drama." Maybe the prayer is, "God, may they see you with me inside of this fire, inside of this drama." God is with you. God is for you. God is making his appeal through you. Each of you are a unique expression of God throughout the city and throughout the world. And God wants us to be light, to be salt. So this is my clothes tonight. I believe that God is huddling us, you could say, as a church. And I could see God just setting up shop right in the middle of this auditorium. Bring it in, guys. Bring it in, okay? I know there's drama at work. I know there's drama in the family. Those people in your apartment complex are driving you crazy. I get it. On the team, the locker room, I get the stuff. I get how hard it is. I get the struggle. But when we gather together like this, we're filled with strength. We're filled with power. We're reminded. Our eyes are opened back to the mission. My Holy Spirit resides on the inside of you. So as a church, don't stay and keep your faith hidden into the four walls of the church. When we break this huddle, each of you has an assignment. Each of you is a unique expression. Execute the plan. Execute the purpose. Let's break this huddle and let's go be the church. Let's be a rescue boat and love those that are around us. Lift those that are around us. Show up and help. And watch God do miracles and watch God change lives and watch marriages get restored You are the only Bible some may ever read. I don't know that player where he is spiritually, but God wanted to use me that day to just plant a seed. And God wants to use you to even greater lengths, right where you're at, right at Ulta 3, right in the Galleria, right in that body shop, right in that coffee stop, wherever you are, God has you planted there to be an influencer and to change the climate. Let me pray for us. Father, we love you. We thank you that you chose us. We didn't choose you. And you chose us to be the light of the world. You want to shine your light through us. And we want to steward our influence and our platforms for impact, to help people, to love and to lift and to encourage. Father, we pray that you would show yourself through us in a new way. When we go back to work tomorrow, when we go back to our families, to our friendship circles, that we would recognize there is deep purpose right where we are. That we would look for lonely people and look for hurting people and bring words of encouragement and bring joy and bring your love. Awaken us, Jesus. Stir our hearts once again. Give us a fresh new burden for those that are hurting around us, those that are lost, those that you've put strategically around us. May we not look for the next, but be fully present where we find our 2 feet. May we be more aware. And I believe that as we do that, influence will come our way. Your blessings will chase us down. Everything that we need will come to us by your gracious hand. Bless every person under the sound of my voice. Thank you that they're favored and they're anointed with a measure of influence to be your light to the world. We thank you for it in Jesus' name. And everybody said, can we thank God for his word? Can we thank him for his presence? Thank you for his mission. Hey, without anyone leaving, I want to do something for just one more minute. I want to ask a very honest question tonight. Maybe you don't know Jesus. Maybe this is your first time in church. I have good news. You can come to Jesus just as you are. Maybe you've been searching for peace and purpose and a whole lot of stuff, relationships, partying, money, power, success, whatever it is, but finding yourself empty over time, finding yourself not having the peace that you long for. The reality is the peace that your soul craves, only Jesus can provide. The Bible says his peace surpasses understanding. His peace can anchor you. If you want to come home to Jesus, and you want to step into a relationship with him, I'm going to count down from 3. And when I get to 1, I want you to do something bold. And I want you to stand to your feet right where you're at. And I'm going to lead you in a prayer, inviting Jesus into your life so you can step into this purpose that he has for you. And you can step into this life on mission. So 3, 2, if you want to give your life to Christ or even rededicate, 1, I want you to go ahead and stand right now to your feet. And we're going to celebrate you. Come on, church. Can we clap? Can we welcome home all these individuals that are standing all over the room? Incredible. Come on, give a big hand clap. Anybody else want to stand? Anybody else want to come home and find peace, find purpose, find joy? If you're standing, or even if you aren't, you want to receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior, repeat the simple prayer of faith after me. The rest of us, let's repeat it as if it was our first time. Say, Jesus, I stand before you tonight. And I ask you to forgive me of all my sins and all my mistakes. Come into my life. Come into my heart and wash me clean. Tonight I choose to make you my Lord and my Savior. I want to live my life for you and only you. In Jesus' name, amen. Church, can we celebrate all the new beginnings? Maybe here, those of you watching online, we're so proud of you. I want to encourage you to come this weekend to church. Pastor Joel will be preaching. We'd love to see you. I'd love to see you back here Wednesday night. Our pastor gives every one of us this challenge. Give a year of your life to following Jesus and planting your heart in this house, and you'll see a year from now, your life will be forever changed for the better. Can anyone testify to that? Giving your life to Jesus, planting yourself in the house of God, your life will be forever better. But can we all stand to our feet? Hopefully you're leaving inspired, you're leaving lifted and challenged. Hey, let's go be influencers. Let's be salt. Let's be light. Let me leave you with a blessing. Numbers chapter 6. May the Lord bless you and may the Lord keep you. May the Lord show you his favor and have mercy on you. And may the Lord watch over you and give you his peace. We love you. God bless you. Have a great week.